Chase is alive. He killed my friend, now he's coming for me.
He's got a death curse.
Jason's a legend.
I'm Mrs. Warren, an old friend of the Christies.
Jason belongs in hell.
You're doing the biggest day here.
Never come back again.
You see, Jason was my son, and today is his birthday.
Good evening and welcome to another episode of Return to Camp Blood. I am your host, Nathan Barker, and joining me tonight is Ben DeAtley.
Hey, what's up, man?
Now, the Lando is not going to be joining us tonight because, well, he's just too cool for us today, apparently. So, with that being said, I would like to welcome the newest member of the squad, Mr. Kent Mullins, a.k.a. Kenton. Now, some of our listeners might remember Kent from being a guest on past episode number 78, or maybe you're familiar with his Jason Voorhees sculpting over at his business, Black Hat Studios. He does attend some conventions and stuff, so maybe you've had some contact with him at a show. But anyway, a big welcome to the squad, and we definitely look forward to talking shit with you, brother.
I'm excited to be here, man. Excited to get into this.
Yeah, hey, you know what? And for those of you that were listening to Death Curse Radio, you might know Kent and Ben, of course, since we headed up that show, which is no longer going to be in existence, but we'll talk about that a little bit later. So we decided just to bring Kent over on board here with this show, and we've got some new things coming up, and we'll get to that in just a little bit. So before we get started, I would just like to say that we are back in full swing after taking a pretty lengthy and definitely a much needed break to sort of unwind, regroup, maybe refocus, whatever the hell you want to call it, so we can keep bringing you episodes and content about Friday the 13th. Now, with that being said, sometimes it can be very, very quiet at Camp Crystal Lake, believe it or not. So with that in mind, and in order for us to avoid gaps and keep bringing you episodes on what used to be a regular weekly basis, we figured, you know what, why not talk about the horror genre in general to fill those gaps? So pretty much what we were thinking is every Friday fan is a fan of horror films in general for the most part. So why not talk about news and other films and just whatever from time to time to sort of mix things up? Now, I know that some of you probably won't like that idea since we've always been all about Friday the 13th, but don't worry because we're still going to be focusing mainly on Friday the 13th, but we just want to expand a little bit from time to time. So be on the lookout for new episodes with other content as far as that goes. And with this new change, we are pretty much certain, it's not 100% yet, but it pretty much is. And with the new change, we're basically thinking, you know what, with new content, we've got Ben's newer to the show, Kent's new to the show, of course, Lando's sticking around, myself. We thought, you know what, let's just mix it up a little bit and maybe go, instead of being referred to as Return to Camp Blood, how about Camp Blood Radio? And drop us a line, let us know what you think about that. The names are pretty close, but it just kind of leaves us more wide open because I have mentioned in other episodes that we are going to be looking into moving content over to YouTube, so you'll be able to check us out there. And of course, when we meet up with people in person and we do some live recordings, it just gives us a little bit more openness as far as roaming around outside of Camp Crystal Lake. So with all that being said, like I said, just let us know what you think about that. Any questions, comments, or concerns, drop us a line. We appreciate all of our past listeners, and we're definitely looking forward to getting back in the saddle and dropping new episodes weekly. So on to tonight's show. Recently, I read an article comparing the late Richard Brooker, a.k.a. Jason in Part 3, and the great Ted White, a.k.a. Jason in Part 4. And I thought, hey, that is a great idea for us to weigh in on our thoughts as far as the comparison. So for tonight's episode, Brooker or White, that is the question. Also being that with all the changes to the Jason costume throughout the series, Part 3 and Part 4 are the closest and the fairest to actually compare as far as the look goes, and of course it's still being quote unquote human Jason. So to kick things off, we will throw Kenton right into the sharks and pose the question, Brooker or White?
Oh man, I'm White 100%. First off, Friday the 13th Part 4 is my probably in my top two favorite, if not my favorite. That is my, like, whenever I think of Jason Voorhees, that's the one that comes into mind. I do prefer the look of part three more over the four, but in general, yeah, part four, final chapter, Ted White, all the way.
Okay, so before we started recording, you had mentioned, well, one of us had mentioned, I don't know who the fuck said it, but anyways, one of us said that you obviously see way more of Jason in part three than you do in part four. So what is it about Ted White's portrayal that makes your answer Ted White?
Well, first off, this has been said a thousand times, but Jason in part four is just far more brutal. He's on a mission. He's like, he reminds me kind of like the T-1000 in Terminator 2. Whenever I watch part three, the Brooker Jason reminds me of like an angry drunk uncle that is hell bent on beating the hell out of whoever he's going after. He's just kind of clumsy and hopping around. But you know, one thing I do like about the part three Jason is he's also fairly nonchalant. Like the way he kind of drops the spear gun and everything on the deck. But yeah, man, part four is just, he's brutal. He moves with purpose. He's scary. He's just more vicious. And that's what it boils down to. And like you said, you know, the similarities in the costumes between three and four are fairly small in comparison to the other movies. But I love that split in the hockey mask. And, you know, for the most part, they're the same. But if we're going off looks, then I got to go three, just because I've always been a fan of those hunchback mongoloid shoulders that he has. But yeah, man, I just like four because he's a machine. He's vicious. Still human, though.
Yeah, no, he definitely, I like the Terminator comparison. That's good. But no, you're right. He's definitely more brutal. I'll give you that. And the thing, like you said about the drunk uncle or whatever, that's a good comparison too. But maybe, you know what, maybe he was drunk on set, because when you do see him do the mic drop on the dock, he was pretty fucking smooth. And then later on, he's not so smooth.
Yeah, absolutely. So he you know, the J-Man had been like slamming shots in between kills. That's the only excuse I have, because yeah, he goes off smooth and devil. He starts off like smooth and debonair and ends up just fumbling around and getting fucking rage drunk and throwing chairs when he can't find her in the barn. And it reminded me of like a Kentucky dad that's just wanting to beat his children, and the little bastards are hiding in the closet or something whenever he's looking for her. It's just,
and he's got that blind drunken rage. Just, I can't see shit. I don't know where shit is.
Where
just,
are you? You little,
where are you? Bitch? Yep. Exactly. I'm drunk. I can't see straight. Just, you know, flopping around all over hell. No, yeah, that's a good comparison. Definitely. That's fucking funny. Actually, I never even really thought about it like that. But yeah, I mean, like we had talked about earlier, you see way more of him in part three. And I was always, I guess, I don't know if I always leaned more towards part three. I always kind of went with Brooker simply because you've seen more of him, way more of him. And as you guys know, you don't see shit out of Jason much until the climactic ending, and then it's on from there. And it would have been interesting to see Ted's portrayal in part three as much as you got to see Brooker in the drunken rampage, if you want to call it that, or the nonchalant mic drop on the dock. I would have been, it's kind of hard to really make a fair comparison. You almost have to flip-flop them in the films to really be able to do it fairly. But being that these are the only two that are really somewhat in comparison, it just kind of is what it is. But I agree with you. I like part three better. That's one of my favorites. So I'm always going to be partial to Brooker, and I love his portrayal as Jason, but I'm right there with you in the fact that Ted White was just vicious. And I got to go with even though the minimal amount that we got to see him, I'm gonna pick Ted White in this one. It's a very, very difficult decision, but I'm gonna go with Ted simply because of the little bit that we do see. You couldn't have got much better than that.
It's much more memorable, I feel like.
Absolutely. And most of the things with part three that are memorable, at least for me, I mean, they're not vicious like that. I mean, they're good parts, like we keep mentioning the mic drop or whatever. I would have liked to have seen Ted portray some of those, and then I would have been able to make a better decision. But I don't know if Ted would have been as smooth. Maybe he would have when it came down to those parts, and maybe it would have been a totally different take when Ted was in the barn. I don't know when Ted was if he were the one in there throwing shit around. But
and, like you know, I said, me and you were talking about this before we started too, and you tapped on it here just for a little bit there for a second. We also aren't entirely sure how much influence the director had on those portrayals. So, you know, who's to say that Ted Watt, had he been placed in part three and flip-flopped, they wouldn't have played the exact same way. Do you know what I mean?
Absolutely. And that's why I mentioned that before we got started here was I've never had the opportunity to speak with Steve Miner yet. Anyway, he was at a convention that I was at several years ago, but he didn't show up until he was supposed to be there all weekend. And he didn't show up until Saturday late in the day. So I didn't get a chance to talk to him, but that would be my question for Steve is if the mannerisms and what you see in the barn or the drunken uncle rage or whatever the hell you want to call it, if that was directed or if that was just the way that Richard portrayed the character, because you do see, like we mentioned, basically two different versions. So maybe, who knows, maybe someday we'll get a chance to have him on the show. I know that he doesn't do many interviews, so I doubt that'll ever happen. But if I catch him out at a convention somewhere, that's definitely something that I'm going to ask, because it would be definitely, that makes a big difference whether, hey, I was directed to do it or no, that was just my own take. So yeah, that could have been a possibility. And I don't know that we'll ever really find the answer out to that. Of course, maybe we could ask Ted White if he was given any direction. I never really thought about that. But I think, you know, Ted's been pretty, if you listen to some of the interviews if you've ever had a chance to talk to him, that he wasn't that familiar with the character when he got the parts. So he had to go back through and watch films before he ever, you know, stepped onto set. So, Ben, your thoughts, Brooker or White?
Well, I think it's a really good question, man. And, you know, when we had talked about it a week ago or whatever, and discussing it maybe being a topic for a show, right away I went Brooker right away. Part three, one of my favorite Friday 13ths. It's one of the films that got me into the franchise. And I think Brooker is really kind of the face of Jason. I mean, if you look at the cover of the video game, that's part three Jason on the cover. And so right away I was like, oh, it's got to be Brooker. But then I thought about it. I thought about it a lot, and I went back and I rewatched the final chapter, and I don't know, maybe I'm getting older. I don't know, but I really, you know, went all out and I rewatched the final chapter, and I'm going to say Ted White. Like, I have to agree with you guys. Ted White just, to me, you know, I don't want to step on your guys' toes and repeat everything you just said, but, more evil. Exactly. He's a fucking machine. This is a Jason that just went through a weekend of hell. I mean, he just, you know, Jenny got him with a machete, Chris with the axe. He's pissed off. You know, no one's getting away this time. And really, in the shadows, you don't see him. He's to me, this Jason, Ted White's part four Jason is like a boogeyman Jason. Not to, you know, compare him with Michael Myers or anything, but there's that great shot right before Trish gets him with the machete at the end when he's going for Tommy, and you see the mask just, you know, kind of come out of the shadows, out of the darkness. And it's, he's really, you know, stalking his victims and just more brutal. And I think Richard Brooker really maybe always in light and everything, you know, that probably had a lot to do with the 3D, you know, the lighting and all the setup like that. But yeah, just big, clumsy. Ted White was more stealthy, stalking, and really just fucking scary. I don't know, man. I think Boogeyman Jason is a little bit more scarier than Drunk Uncle Jason.
Drunk Uncle. Leave it up to Kent for the hillbilly Drunk Uncle comparison. I mean, I'm live
in Kentucky, so you know, yeah. I run into those Jasons at Dollar General like every other day.
So you get, being from Kentucky, you get Drunk Uncle Jason, and you get meth smoker Jason.
Yeah, watching part three is just like going to a family reunion for me. It's a little bit close to home.
Good Lord. Good Lord. I can only imagine. So no, I'm right there. Like I said, I think we're all kind of on the same page, but it's really, for me, it's kind of half and half, because I love the mic drop. There are other things about three where you're just like, yeah, that's badass. And then it's a really, really hard question, really. But I think it really just boils down to, like we said, the brutality. Now, the not that there was no brutality in three, because there are definitely some cool parts in there, but for the most part, Jason does not move anywhere near like what we see in part four. And the boogeyman Jason aspect of it, here's the way I look at that, and I agree with you on that, because we don't see Jason hardly at all in the beginning, in the first half, you know, more than the first half of the film. And it is very much so like it's almost like he's stalking them, like you said, more so compared, because we only see limited glances and the suspense is built up. And then when you think you're going to see Jason, you just catch a glimpse, or you're like, or in part three, he's all over the fucking place, all over. So there's no stalking. There's no boogie, or I guess there's no boogeyman aspect in part three whatsoever. And a lot of people think, if you take a poll, most people think part four is the best Friday, or in the top three, no doubt, of all the Friday films. And I hear a lot of people comment on the climactic part about part four, is that, yeah, it is, we don't get to see a lot of him, but when we do, look out. And that's pretty much where I'm at with it.
And you know, when you do see him, and this is where I'm kind of torn here, is when you get down to the aesthetics, because although I love part four and it's probably my favorite, and I'm a huge Ted White fan and that's my go-to guy, purely off aesthetics, I think I prefer the part three look, both on the face underneath the mask and the build. I like the way Richard Brooker looks better in costume than I do Ted White. I like those, like I said, those, you know, big hunchback of Notre Dame shoulders, and the face. I don't know if you, I'm sure you have, Nathan, but you've probably seen the early photos of the face Stan Winston was going to do. Before, you know, they ended up deciding on the one. I ended up liking that and even more than I do on the one that they went with part three. But I just like the look of part three better, hockey mask aside. But yeah, at the end of the day, it still comes down to how much of a badass is he? And that goes to part four.
Yeah, and the under mask look, I'm right there with you. I probably like the Winston look better. It's more of a comparison or a carryover from the original part three look compared to what you see at the end of part four, which I like that look too, don't get me wrong. But yeah, I mean, for one thing, Richard was not a huge guy. He was an athletic built type of person. I think he probably stood 6'3", 6'4".
Super, course, he was really built like CJ Graham.
Not a narrower version. I mean, if you look at pictures of them too, granted, even though they're older, you know, years later, that he would be probably more, he probably a shorter version of maybe Derek Mears, a narrower, okay. Maybe that'd be the more fair comparison. He looks, or maybe like a Doug Tate, something like that, a little shorter, but he's not like when Ted, even at 58 years old, when Ted White shot that film, and when we were all down, when we were at Horror Hound in Columbus back in what, 2017, at the Friday Five reunion, when we were all there and Ted White was there.
Yeah, I
was talking to Ted that day, and I said, I don't remember what we were talking about, but out of the blue, I was just like, hey, just out of curiosity, because now that he's in his 90s and he's, you know, hunched over, and when he's doing his costume appearances now, he just doesn't, you know, he's in his 90s. He doesn't look like he did back then. And I asked him how tall he was in his day, and he said I was 6'4". And, of course, you put boots on him, and I'd probably put him closer to 6'5" or whatever. But he would have been probably – he was a lot, I think, broader back in his day, even at 58 years old. I mean, look at him. He was a pretty good-sized, solid guy. Whereas, I guess what I'm getting at with this is when you look at part three, if you didn't – already know, if you can't tell by looking at it, is they obviously put padding on Richard Brooker to make him look bulkier. And it, you can especially see it in the arms if you really, or if you freeze frame it or whatever. But to me, it's pretty noticeable because he wasn't a hulking type of guy. He was, when you see behind the scenes pictures or whatever, and you see him sitting there with no shirt on, he's cut, but he's just not like a jacked guy. Does that make sense? Like, I think Ted had more of just the bigger, broader build even at 58 years old, whereas they had to put, you know, padding on Brooker.
Yeah, Richard was built like a swimmer.
Yeah, there you go.
And while we're on the topic of of 900-year-old Ted White, can we send out an open letter to all conventions and ask him to please stop putting him in costume? For the love of God. Man.
I'll tell you what, the first one that he did, shit, I can't remember off the top of my head which one it was. And it might have been the one out in Arizona. Maybe it was Mad Monster. I can't remember. But anyways, I see that they're going to do the costume photo ops. And I thought, oh, okay, this is either going to be good or it's going to be really, really, really bad. And like I said, I have all the respect for Ted White in the world. I think that Ted is a model American. He's when you think of America, that's Ted White. And if anybody doesn't know what I mean by that, Google Ted White and look at his accomplishments with the military, college football player, stuntman, et cetera, et cetera.
Oh, he's a total badass.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, that would have been a guy. I mean, that guy's got some stories. And if anybody has not yet ever had the chance, if you see him at a convention this year, definitely take the time to spend a few minutes with him. The guy is just phenomenal to talk with. We've had him on past episodes here. Maybe I'll invite him to come on again if he's up to it. But phenomenal with the stories. Very well traveled, many, many life experiences. And so I can't remember where I was even going with that. But anyways,
so we're talking about him being in costume.
Yeah, we're talking about the convention thing. So the first picture that I see, because of course everybody posts them on social media, and the first one that I see, he has his outfit. I don't know who made the first outfit that he was wearing, or maybe it's the only one that he's been wearing. I haven't even bothered to pay attention to know who made that. And for one, it looked like he slept in it, and it was just wrinkled all to hell and everything. The weathering, I was just like, I'm not, I don't know.
If we're going off Jason's, that should have been the part three Jason, because he would have been drunk.
Right. Exactly. That was drunk uncle. He passed out on the couch.
That's a drunk uncle thing to do.
Exactly. But it just, the weathering was not, to me, was not appropriate. And I dabble a little bit into the costumes, as you guys know. So I'm just like, okay, not a good look there. But he still had his wedding ring on, and he was sitting down. And he didn't have a hood on. He didn't have a latex or silicone hood on. So he just had the hockey mask on and his hair sticking out. And the wedding ring and the way that the costume looked like he slept in it and then wore it on the plane there. Like, I was just like, wow, I'm glad I did not pay money for that.
And, you know, and I want to also reiterate, because you said it, but I want to say it too so people don't get mad at me. I love Ted White. He's a fucking model American, but we all get old. Everybody gets old. He's just too old to do this, and that's no fault of him. It's just, it's fucking nature, man. And at a certain point, you just got to just take the picture standing there. You're Ted White. It's just as amazing as Ted White.
Right. I mean, like I said, the guy, he used to be 6'4" back in the day, and obviously he's in his 90s. I mean, when I'm in my 90s, I'm not going to be, I'll be under 6 foot tall by then, I'm sure, because I'm probably going to shrink, you know, 4 or 5 inches or whatever, just like whenever you see the old guys out and about and they're all hunched over, it's just, that's what happens. And I don't think that they should put him in costume either. I think if anything, he could stand there or sit there and he could hold a mask in his hand or maybe a machete, but there's no reason, it's not doing him any justice to put him in a costume photo op. I wouldn't want to, I mean, once again, no disrespect to Ted, but it doesn't look right. And you know, you're charging people out the ass for these photo ops, and they're not doing anything but getting more and more expensive. So I think for everybody involved, it would probably be just a better idea just to kind of, like I said, maybe have him hold a mask and a machete, but definitely not putting him in a full costume.
Yeah, I remember we were, I want to say Whorehound, may have been Columbus. Me and you, Nathan, we were waiting in line for our photo op. And they had the Ted White, you know, photo op. They were going right before us. I think there was like three people in line, and it was just, I don't even know if it was worth it to even go through all of that, you know?
Yeah. And that's the thing, you have, you know, Tom Morga was there, and Tom was awesome. I got the costume photo op with Tom. Kent here. Kent did Tom's hood for that one, I believe, didn't you, Kent? That was your hood that Tom was wearing at around Columbus 2017 for that photo op.
Yeah, he's still using it today.
Yeah, and you did a great job with that. And Tom still looks good. And the photo op for that one was great. He was posing with people and stuff. And he's still in pretty good shape for his age. Tom's in his 70s. But there's a big difference between being in your 70s and being in your mid 90s. And I just, like I said, for respect purposes, I just think that Ted, they should not put Ted in a costume. But I will say, to the defense of that, some of the, I don't know, maybe second, third, fourth costume photo ops, however many he's done now, I think he's done at least four, but they did put him in a hood and it looked way better. But physically with him, with you know, the wear and tear on his body and the way that he stands,
it's a 90-year-old.
Exactly. Just the way that he's kind of hunched over and the way that he's standing there. I just don't think it does him justice. I don't think it does the character or anybody else justice. And if they are going to do it, it should be at a very, very reduced cost. You know what I mean? $60, $80, $100 for these photo ops with something like that. It's not doing anybody any justice there other than to say, oh, it's Ted White in the costume. But the later costume that I seen, especially like the last one, there was one, I can't remember what show it was, where it was, and I'll throw this out there too. It was all a ton of the Jasons, you know, Ken Kersinger, CJ was there, Kane, Ted, Tom. It was like six of them.
Days of the Dead, wasn't it?
No, I can't remember which one it was. I can't remember which one it was now, but they've done it a couple times now, but this was the first one. And of course, Ted, like I said, being as hunched over, he looked really small, where in comparison, Ted was just as big as the rest of them. And it just kind of, like I said, I guess I look at it more of as a respect thing.
And, you know, it's impressive enough that this man at his age is still capable of getting on a plane and flying to all these conventions and being there all day for a whole weekend. That's crazy enough.
Like, oh, absolutely. And I remember, hell, like 5 years ago. Let's see. Yeah, it was at the 30th anniversary reunion for part four in Indianapolis. At Mask Fest that year. And Ted, I was actually, I spent the weekend sitting at Tim Schultz's table from Crypt Keeper 9 Productions, just kind of helping him out. And right across from us was Ted and Judy and Peter Barton. I forget who else was there. You know, Ari Lehman, Adrian King, or some other Friday people that were right there with us. And I don't know how many times, and Ted would have been like 88 at the time, I think. And he would have been 88. And that guy, whenever anybody asked to take a picture, he always stood up. And I heard him tell somebody, I don't know if it was his handler or somebody, and somebody made the comment about, you know, you must be tired from getting up and sitting down, you know, up and down literally 8 hours and doing it like 3 days in a row. And he said, you know what, that's what the fans came here for. And that's what I'm going to give them. And it's like, wow, you know, it just makes you have that much more respect for him. So when we saw Ted in Columbus nearly a couple of years ago now, when I was standing there talking to him, and I said, you look good, Ted. I said, what are you doing to keep yourself busy? And he said, you know what? I've been playing a lot of golf, but you can only play so much golf. And I'm thinking, for one, I probably won't even make it to 90, let alone be able to swing a fucking golf club at 90 years old. I mean, the guy's just amazing, plain and simple.
Dude, I play putt-putt golf and get winded.
Right.
I'm 32.
Well, that's what I'm saying. I mean, I some days I wake up and I can't hardly move, and I'm not even 40 yet. So I'm not looking forward to what 92 or 93 would be, even if I make it there. You know, like I said, I'd be right there with you. I'd have to take a break after two or three holes of putt-putt golf.
Yeah, and add on the fact that he was a stuntman for all, you know, all those years, you know, all the wear and tear on his body. He's definitely hardcore, man.
Absolutely. And he played college football and he fought in a war. I mean, the guy is like literally the fucking definition of America. I mean, really.
He was birthed from the ass of a bald eagle.
I think so. I think so. Yeah.
You don't have to do anything else to impress us, Ted.
No, he really doesn't. He doesn't. And I appreciate so much about him and all of his contributions, whether it be to the country or to the film business or the fans or whatever. The guy is a class act. But I'm right there with you, though. I'm going to chalk it up to a respect thing about the costume photo ops. I think they should just let him sit there or stand there and just hold a mask up and put a machete up to somebody or something like that. I'd be just as thrilled to do that. Hell, I'm just as thrilled to be in a regular picture with him, let alone something else like that, you know?
Yeah, and you know, another thing, I've gotten to meet him I don't know, probably 5 or 6 times. And he's just so humble and personable and friendly and open to questions. And, you know, he obviously his memory is not probably what it once was, but he'll stand there and talk for as long as you want to. And he's such a, just a, on top of everything that he's done and everything that he's been through, he's still sweet, just a sweet man. Just, I can't say enough good things about him. I really,
absolutely. I'm right there with you. And he's a Scotch drinker. He's a Scotch drinker too. So add that on top of his badassery.
On top of that, he's the most interesting man in the world. I don't.
You know what? There's all these memes. You see all these memes with that guy from the beer commercial. Somebody needs to fucking change that guy out with Ted White.
Yeah, just Photoshop his. Yeah, absolutely.
Actually, we might just have to do that. You know,
actually,
what?
Why don't they just make Ted White that? He's still got the umph and the enthusiasm to do commercials. I would watch the hell. That would be. I would buy Dos Equis every fucking weekend for the rest of my life if they would make Ted White the new Dos Equis guy.
That's what all the drunk uncles in fucking Kentucky would be doing. I can tell you that right now.
Exactly.
Why not even have Ted White have his own brand of bourbon with a hockey mask on it and shit? I mean, Adrian King's got wine. Why can't Ted White have bourbon?
I'd drink it. I'd buy it.
Fuck yeah. I'd buy it too. But you know what, Ben? That's a job for you, buddy. You take your graphic design skills and you change out the meme and put Ted White on there.
I am totally on it, man.
So be on the lookout for that, because that would definitely be a game changer, right? That'll be viral, I guarantee it, in the Friday community.
I hope
so.
Have either of you tried any of
Adrian King's wine?
I have not. I keep saying, because I see her quite frequently and she'll just bring it to the show. You don't have to pay shipping or whatever. And I keep saying I'm going to order some, but other than that, I'm not like a wine connoisseur, or I can't even tell you the last time I even had a sip of actual wine. So I'd probably get it and I probably wouldn't like it anyway, but the bottle would be on display in my collection for sure.
We got a bottle of it. Me and my wife did it at Scarefest, like 3-4 years ago. It's actually really good. I'm not endorsing Adrian King's wine company, but if you do pass it at a convention, grab you a bottle, 'cause it's pretty good. My wife is an avid wine drinker. So we enjoyed it.
Yeah. And I'm sure there's probably, I think she has what, 5 or 6 different flavors or kinds or whatever the hell you want to call them. And I'm sure there's one there that I could probably tolerate, but I'm just not much of a wine person in general. So, but I definitely want one just for display purposes. That's for damn sure.
Yeah. I'm more of a, you know, I was raised on a tobacco farm. So the only thing that my digestive tract and bladders will process is Natty Light and cheap whiskey. But my wife seemed to like it. So,
well, we need to lobby for Ted White bourbon, and you're in bourbon country, so that's going to be on you.
I'm right in the middle of it, baby.
Exactly. So you need to lobby for Ted White bourbon. But I look at Ted as he's a man of prominence, but he's like a working man too. So it needs to not be the most expensive, but definitely not cheap. It needs to be classy. And speaking of classy, I will put Ted White up there with one of the best, snazziest dressing people at a convention.
Not him and Bruce Campbell.
I was going to say, he's right up there with fucking Bruce Campbell. And Ted has, I mean, some snazzy ass jackets. He has this one that's like all red with white lines on. It's kind of like a red plaid. And I'm telling you what, that will rival some of Bruce Campbell's jackets, hands down.
Like 007 aged hanging out at conventions. That's what it reminds me of.
Yeah. I mean, if you've seen Ted White walking around with this snazzy ass jacket and a glass of scotch, I mean, all dressed up, you know, and you're just like, you can't beat it. You can't. I mean, he's got Bruce Campbell beat, and as far as I'm concerned, in the badassery department.
Especially when you know his backstory, like his personal
story. And if you haven't seen it, I strongly urge you, go to YouTube and do a search of Ted White Starman. And there's a clip of him out in the parking lot in Starman, and he's got a few lines. And just do yourself a favor, if you're a Ted White fan and you haven't seen it, go to YouTube, Ted White Starman, and watch the clip. You guys know what I'm talking about. Have you seen it?
I actually, I have not. This is the I've heard of it, but I've never seen it myself. No.
All right, Ben.
No, I've actually just wrote it down so I can check it out when we're done recording, man.
Yep. It's just a few minutes long, and definitely you got to watch it because that's like Ted in his like prime. This would have been right around the same time that Friday 4 was filmed. It was probably within, I think, a year apart. It might have been the same year. I can't remember, but I know they're very, very close as far as when they were filmed. So, yeah, classic Ted White that you don't usually get to see aside from the Western movies and his stunts and all that stuff, or obviously when he's playing Jason and he's all masked up. So it's just cool to see him in that capacity. So, all right. So to kind of wrap things up, I mean, I think we're on the same page as far as we all pretty much said Ted White. As far as to answer the question, Brooker or White, Ted White, 3 for 3. But that's definitely no disrespect, nothing against the late, great Sir Richard Brooker. I love Part 3. It's one of my favorite films. I do love his portrayal of Jason. I've said that on past episodes that he was right up there too. But I don't know. I mean, over time and just kind of reflection, I gotta go with Ted White on this one. And as far as Richard goes, if you have not seen the Friday the 13th Part 3 memoriam documentary from our friend of the show, friend of mine, Sean Richards, executive producer, it's available for free on YouTube on Ben here on his YouTube channel, Friday the 13th Network. Ben, why don't you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, you can check it out. It's youtube.com/F13Network. And I mean, it's definitely, obviously, one of our, you know, highest viewed videos. I think it's closing in on 100,000 views. And I mean, just really, really positive reaction to it. A lot of comments, a lot of questions. And it's really cool, man. It's cool to see the fans with, you know, just that type of appreciation for Richard Brooker and the film itself, Part 3. So really, really good video, recommended to every Friday 13th fan, horror fans. I mean, watch it. You'll love it.
Yep. Lots of familiar faces in there. And the best thing, it is free. So if you're not familiar with Ben's channel already, Friday the 13th Network, get your ass over to YouTube, check it out. Lots of good shit on there. We are about at the end of the month. So his notorious 13 on 13 that he does, that he drops on the 13th of every month, that's Friday updates and news, et cetera, et cetera. You know, get on there and check out some of those episodes. Another one will drop in a couple weeks. Other than that, final thoughts on Brooker or White, Kenton?
White, all the way, man. And, you know, in closing, I want to say I've been a little hard on Part 3. I think maybe not too bad, but I also love Part 3. I mean, that's good old-fashioned, bare-bone, like meat and potato, just Friday the 13th with no bullshit attached to it. And I'm always going to love Part 3. But, you know, when you compare it to Part 4, I'm going to lean Part 4.
Gotcha. Like I said, 3 is one of my favorites too. I prefer 3 over 4, and I love 4 too. But like I said, we get to see a lot more Jason and so on and so forth. But it's regardless, it's almost an impossible question. If I could basically say 50-50, that would be my answer, because the up until the end of Part 4, that's pretty much all I have to gauge the comparison on. So in reality, I'm gonna just to answer the question, I'm gonna say White, but then again, it's more like a 50-50, if that makes any sense. So final thoughts there, Benjamin.
Yeah, Ted White, you know, I think maybe like Kent said, maybe a little hard on Part 3. I think Brooker's performance, you know, in Part 3 being such a great film makes us really kind of like Part 4 a little bit more, you know, drawing from that, you know, the ending and everything in Part 3 going right into, you know, Part 4, it makes us maybe enjoy Part 4 a little more. I don't know. But, yeah, Ted White absolutely knocked it out. I think, you know, he had a little bit more, he had help, he had inspiration from Part 2 and 3. And I think he did a real good job of kind of mixing them. Maybe we got a little hillbilly Jason, but we still got a little Part 3 Jason while doing his own thing. So yeah, Ted White all the way, man. Who would win in a fight, you know, if they were to face off? I don't know. I mean, Brooker is a lot bigger, but if Ted White, you know, if it was happening at Camp Crystal Lake and Ted White had, you know, environment, the shadows and everything to stalk him, I think Ted White would take him. So Ted White all the way, but still a lot of love for Part 3 and Richard Brooker.
And how much had part three been drinking?
Well, and that's the thing too, is we got to have a little bit of fun with this. So by all means, no disrespect to the late great Richard Brooker, but I got to give it to Kent. That's fucking hilarious, is the drunken uncle. So yeah, no disrespect, but yeah, that's funny shit. All right. Anything else before we wrap this up? Otherwise we're good to go.
Fingernails, you know, Ted White, awesome part four, but without the black fingernails. That's what I gotta end it on. That
ending it on the dirty fingernails. All right, any yeah, thoughts on that, Kemp?
No, I agree with that 100%. I never understood that, but it is what it is.
Well, you know, I mean, some people just don't have the best hygiene. I guess we can chalk it up to that. I don't think Jason's hygiene is the best, you know.
I'm not much better, so I can't say shit.
Well, yep, you know how you Kentuckians are down there hanging out at the Dollar General, and some of us aren't even allowed at McDonald's, but we won't get into that story because I don't want to put you on the spot quite yet.
Yeah, we'll save that for another time.
Yeah, I may or may not be saying that Kenton is banned from a particular McDonald's in Kentucky, but we'll let him tell you that story. You'll have to tune in on the next episode to hear the Kenton banned from McDonald's story.
They asked for it, man.
All right, well, that wraps up another episode of Return to Camp Blood, possibly Camp Blood Radio on the next episode. We're still weighing out our options on that, but let us know what you think. And also, please rate and review wherever the hell you listen to the show at. Also, check us out on Facebook at Camp Blood Pod. And please leave us a review there on the Facebook page. We would definitely appreciate that. And if you want to check out our back episodes, you can find those on our website, campbloodpodcast.com. And if you have any questions, comments, concerns, feel free to drop us a line. Until next time.